Hello explorers, and welcome to another video. Another day, another video, another Monday. And today we're going to talk a little bit about OpenCL and the applications of running workloads on a GPU. And OpenCL is really fascinating because this is an open standard. It will work with pretty much any newer graphics cards. In Windows, if you are using NVIDIA cards, you just have to have CUDA installed. I don't know about AMD cards, how you do it in Windows, but in Linux, you just have to install your either CUDA or your graphics driver for your specific card and get that working under Linux. Then you install the OpenCL kernel headers, and you also install the OpenCL package for that specific brand of graphic card. So it's quite easy to get it to work in the different environments, and I won't go into that in this video, but I will look at how you implement something in OpenCL and compare it a bit to CUDA. And I have a video of that too. If you just follow the link up top there, I will show you how to use CUDA with workloads on the GPU. So first off, you need some program that you want to run on the GPU. And this is a very simple program. You have a kernel defined here. This is a sample kernel. You have two float arrays and float array that you have as a result. So A and B are inputs and C is an output. You get a global identifier here, and then you will in your result set the A and B times each other. So it's a very simple program. It just multiplies a number of values. And then if we go into the main program here, you will create up a few buffers here. You will add some values to those buffers. You will create some pointers to those buffers. And now comes some boilerplate here. You have a platform index, device type, and device index. So this is pretty much saying that you want the first platform you can find and the first device you can find of any type. So the first GPU you find on this platform of any type. So if you have a lot of different GPUs, these values might be something that you want to change. And then we set that we will throw exceptions if anything goes wrong, so we get errors, and that's a good thing to do. If you have and here we will just fetch all the platforms in the system and select one of those here. So you will get the ID of that platform. And here we will get all the devices, and we will select one device. So here you have 12 lines of code only to get the specific GPU that you want to work on. Then we create some context for this platform. With these lines here, and we will create a command queue that will run on the device that will run the specific workload that we want. And here we are starting to do something with our specific data. We create some buffers for this data. So we have a bunch of floats here, inputs and outputs. And then we take the program we had earlier and we create a new program from source. We build the program. And in CUDA, we saw that we could actually build in the pre-steps. We had a pre-built binary. There are programs to do this with OpenCL as well, because it's a standard. You can build them beforehand. And the thing there is that it's different programs for each platform. So I won't go in for that today, that day either. And then we will create a kernel in memory of this built program. We will set some kernel arguments. So these are the inputs and outputs that we want to use. And then we will set a global work size and a local work size. And the global work size is the full workload that you want to work with, and the local work size is how much you want to do in each unit. And in this case, we have one workload in each unit, so we only want to do one computation in each unit, and we want to have the full global size. And the important thing here is that the global size and the local work size has dependency on each other, so the global work size need to be some multiple of the local work size. And you can actually run work without specifying the local work size at all, and then it will give you a reasonable amount of local work size, which it could be a bit strange, because then you don't know how much work you will do. So setting both of these is good, so you know what dimensions you're working on. And we work in one dimension, so we are not working with something in 3D or 2D, we're only working in one dimension. So if you're working with an image, you want to work in two dimension, and if you're working with some 3D objects, you want to work in three dimension. But I will go into that later. And then we have this enqueue read buffer. It will read the result back from the memory object 2. So it will actually give some data back to this destination buffer that we had earlier. And then we will release all the objects we had here. So everything will be thrown away, because now we have done our work. So if you want to do multiple sets of work, then you can use them over again and don't release the memory. But as we are working with something that has memory that we allocate memory to, then we need to release it afterwards. It's very common in C language to allocate memory and then deallocate when you're done with it. And lastly here, they have some code that goes through and checks that all the different calculations were done correctly. So this is the sample code that you can find as the first example on the OpenCL JOCL site. So JOCL is the Java binding for OpenCL, or the Java implementation of OpenCL. So that's the package I'm using here. I have just added it to my POM file. We can look at that fast here. So I have open YOSL 2.0.0. So that's the version I'm running right now. So that's a simple program. But as I want to compare it with this workload that we did in CUDA, I want also to look at that program and how to do a blur on an image. So in our other example, we did a blur. We have a kernel again. We have some image size, and there is actually something called an int2, and that's a tuple that will have an x and a y coordinate. So you can say that the image size is an x and y. So that's pretty nice to be able to send those values directly into the program. And then we have the image. So that's a pointer to a buffer that has our image, the start image. We have a pointer to a buffer with our filter. So that's a three by three square with our little filter logic. And then we have a buffer pointer to a result. And then we have our filter site. I just set it here to 3 because I had it earlier in the other CUDA example, but that was a global constant. And here I don't know exactly how to do global constants. I didn't think that was that important. Then I get the global ID I want to work on. And this is a little interesting here, because when you get a global ID and you have set a local size that you want to work on, you will actually get a global ID that is origo, or in the middle of your local size. So you want to work around that middle point. So that was something that I had to work around and figure out how it actually was implemented. And then I get the width and height of my image. So you see here I use the tuples. I get x and y values. So that's my width and height. And then we have my summary function here. And this is not much that I have changed from my earlier example. I use a multiple 24, which is something built into the platform. And I've saw another example using that function. I guess that will actually do a better calculation for me and perhaps speed up things. And it's probably not that important because we compiled the program beforehand, so maybe this little micro optimization wasn't necessary. You see here that I minus one on my y-axis, so if I have my filter 3x3 square, I want to start by the value one back because I'm in the middle of the work. So minus one on the y-axis and minus one on the x-axis will put me up in the top of the workload. So I will work on the full set of data. And the filter is pretty much the same here. And then when I come down here, I will save it to the x and y value. Beforehand, I had x plus one and y plus one and x plus one, but that's not needed here because we are starting from the middle point. So this is the little kernel that I wrote. So let's look at the program. Here we have the kernel that I will send in. It's a filter dilute, and we have some values here that will make a very subtle blur on an image. Then I have some small code here just to read a file. So it will read a file name, which is a string, and give me a string back. So that's not important. So I use it here. I have this test kernel that we saw, and I read it into my kernel source. Again, set the exception. Then we have all this boilerplate of looking for devices and setting up context and so on, and building my program and creating my kernel. Here I have my little reading image code. So I get my pixels back, and I also do a grayscale of the image. So we will work on a grayscale image, which makes things much simpler. I get my pixels, and I start a counter to see how long this operation will take. Then we will fix a value that is number of elements. So this is the width and height. So we get all the pixels. It's pretty much the size of the image. And then I will create a few buffers here. I will create some pointers to my pixels, filter dilute, and also a result set. And the result set is exactly the same size as the pixels. So we get the same image back. I will create three buffers here, and they will have the values of an int with number of elements, an int with the filter dilute length, so that's the size of my filter, and then we have again int and the number of elements. So these are the three memory buffers that we will work on when I work on my image. And then down here we set some arguments to my kernel. The first argument is this int 2 that I talked about. It's a width and height. And then we have the three memory elements that I defined earlier. The global work size is the width and height of the image, and the local work size is a buffer of 3x3, which is the filter size that the different kernels inside of my GPU will work on. So that's the actual size that it will split up the workload in. And as we see here, when we set our enqueue range for the kernel, we say that we work in two dimensions now. And then we set our global size and our work size. And down here, we fetch the memory back. So we read the output data. So this is at the memory 2 position, and the number of elements that we want back, and the pointer to that element set. And then we free all our pointers again. And down here we take our grayscale image, get the raster, and sets all the pixels back to our result, from our result. And we write the grayscale image out. And if we run this little program, we can look at the output. Here we have the sample image that I will work on. And before we have this image, so this is just grayscale and not any filtering. And if we look at the result here, it's very subtle, but you can see a little bit of a blur on this image. So that's the little function that I wanted to show you today. And I think that the big difference between CUDA and OpenCL is that OpenCL has a bit more boilerplate in it. And if you are working with OpenCL, I should recommend you to create some class or object that you keep all your kernel program and command queue variables inside, and that you use that and have some initialization and some deconstructing in that class, and you send workloads to that class or kernels and so on. So building some little framework around this would be quite nice. It's very close to OpenGL and how you build work in OpenGL. OpenGL has even more boilerplate, but I think it's pretty nice because it's open and it's a standard and it works on all graphics cards. So if you want to build something that you can reuse on different systems and you don't want to tie yourself to a specific brand or a specific manufacturer, then OpenCL is a quite good solution to go forward with. I hope that you found this little video interesting. I hope that you learned something today. And if you like this video, give it a like. Share it with your friends and colleagues. If you haven't subscribed yet, please do that. And I really hope to see you in the next video.